Thank you, Daniela. It is time for the headliner presented by Miller Lite. Our guest is the voice of the Detroit Tigers on Fox Sports Detroit, the one and only Matt Shepard. And Matt, thanks for joining us on the headliner. I really can't believe the baseball season is already over. It seems like it just started.
I know. I'm having withdrawal right now, Art. And the reason I'm disappointed is because even though this team struggled down the stretch, I really enjoyed watching Willie Castro and Jamer Candelario, Tarek Skubal, Isak Paredes, Daz Cameron. I loved watching them and seeing them grow a little bit. But we'll wait until February, March and see how they pick up down there in spring training, hopefully.
You know, I know that on previous shows, we thought what the Tigers' record was going to be. I had them at 27-33. I was extremely optimistic that they were going to play 60 games, I guess, to begin with. But yeah. I know you've only had a few days here to kind of look at it all, but the tapestry has been painted on the 2020 season, so to speak. What were your expectations and how did they change now that you see the complete picture?
Well, you and I talked and I think I had them about 25 wins. So I was pretty close. I think you were pretty close. You know, remember all the one run loss games that they had. They at one point lost four straight one-run games, and they had a couple of those which I thought late in the game that they should have put away, but they didn't do that. You know, it's a huge offseason, as you know, Art. But I think overall, I think there was some growth by some guys. I thought some guys took a step backwards, and I think what that does is that bodes really well for competition going to Lakeland, and I think that's something that we should all be looking forward to. You and I have talked throughout the season about we wanting to see the young guys. How much does it take for us to be convinced whether a young guy is good enough to play or not good enough to play? That's up to the individual. Like, for example, Jake Rogers playing 35 games a year ago doesn't tell me whether or not he can play. But next year will be huge for him. He needs to elevate his game enough where he's in the conversation for at least the backup position as a catcher. So I think what we've got here is we've got a great anticipation in the offseason, Art, where we can look forward to seeing how the young guys handled their offseason as major leaguers and how they come back next year. The other thing I loved about what this team did is, remember, there was a time where they lost nine straight. And then they come out and they beat Cleveland in a series. This is a team that I think showed at times that it can handle some adversity, deal with some disappointment, and still bounce back. Individual players did the same thing. Jamer Candelario started 0-17 on the season. He was named AL Player of the Week at one point and finished with a .297 batting average. I think those are all really positive things moving forward.
You know, it's interesting when you said about young players and the maturation. I guess I go back to what Mike Babcock said, and I know you heard him say this a million times when people would ask him about ice time or players' ice time or when are kids ready. And he always would say, look, that's not up to me. And you know, at the professional level, it's up to them. They're the ones that are going to earn it. And if they earn the ice time, you bet they're going to be out there because, you know, ultimately his job is to win games. And going with that kind of philosophy, when I look at it, let's go to a couple of the individual players. First and foremost, I know we talked about the Candyman and we'll touch upon him, but Willie Castro, you know, he's going to play, I would imagine, 104 more games next year. If he's healthy, plays all of them, 162 of them. I am kind of curious when you look at Willie Castro, do you think he has enough of a sample size where you think he has arrived? I know it's a tough question where he has arrived, even though I do think he has to still become a little bit better fielder at shortstop.
First, let me address what you said earlier, because it's a great example. You're right. The players do dictate that. The difference between hockey and baseball, they have a tendency to keep them back if the team isn't ready to compete because they don't want to lose into free agency in 6 years.
Right.
So there's a slight difference there. The other thing I used to love talking with Mike Babcock about was whether or not certain players belong in certain spots. I brought this up to him one time. I said, Brad Stewart's a really good defenseman. Why isn't he a one or a two? Why not just elevate him as a one or a two? And he said, because some guys are just really good where they are. In other words, Brad Stewart was a hell of a three or four, depending on how you wanted to look at it, playing against certain lines. That's why he was that good. Why take him out of that spot? You and I had this conversation earlier this year. Jacoby Jones. Maybe he's just really good as a nine hitter. Don't mess with him. Let him have really good success as a nine hitter and be done with it. And that's fine. So with Willie Castro, I have not seen enough. I don't know how many people could possibly say they have. However, I think what we've seen warrants a much longer look for him. And that's all you can really ask for a young player. I can't sit here and tell you that Willie Castro is going to be an everyday shortstop right now. I don't think he's going to hit 367 in a full season. That's not fair to Willie Castro. But I do believe he warrants a long look. I believe he goes into spring training next year deservedly as the number one shortstop on this team. I also know his character and how hard he's going to work on the offseason. Because if he wants to be better, a better fielder than a guy like Tim Anderson, who's known for his bat and not a very good fielder because of throwing errors, and oftentimes he gets off balance and oftentimes he doesn't field the ball where he's supposed to, then Willie Castro understands he's got to work diligently on his defense. And he's done that. He did it all season long, Art. He did it in the offseason. He's ready to take that mantle as an everyday shortstop. He deserves that. But he cannot get lazy on throws. He cannot mix up his feet oftentimes the way he has, and he can't afford to be fielding the ball outside his body unless it's absolutely necessary. He's got to do what Alan Trammell and Ramon Santiago have hammered into his head every single day. Field the ball in the middle of your body and take your time, plant your feet, have good footwork, and make an accurate throw. Too many times we saw him make bad plays defensively, and at the major league level with young pitchers on the mound, Art. That extends innings. That is not what young pitchers need. If you want Tarek Skubal and you want Casey Mize and Matt Manning and Joey Wentz and guys like that, you better have a rock solid defense behind you, because these kids, the reason their pitch count climbs already is their inability to put hitters away. They learn that. They can adapt to that. But it's hard to overcome fielding errors and poor defensive play behind them.
Well, right. I mean, you know, what is it? You know, if you're giving a team four or five outs an inning, chances are you're losing that ball game. So
that's right. I mean, that's like allowing teams in football to convert third and 10, to convert fourth and three, extend drives. You can't do it, especially if you got a young pitcher on the mound.
Yeah, I, you know, we mentioned the Candyman, and real quickly, 0 for 16. Or 17, I guess it was. And then he was like, he closed out the year like 1 for 25. But in between, he was AL Player of the Week. Real interesting case with him. I think he wants to play third. I know Miguel Cabrera has expressed interest next year playing some first base. But depending on how that all shakes out with Isak Paredes and guys of that ilk, it's a real interesting scenario in the infield. But the Candyman, I think, has proven that he does belong. He's definitely going to be in that lineup. Just where do you think he's going to play in the infield?
Well, he's got over 1,300 at-bats, so I definitely think he belongs. I think that's a long enough sample size. I love, as you and I said, his ability to overcome some adversity. Where does he play? Look, I thought he was a really good third baseman for this team. But this team doesn't have any first baseman. And they don't have any first baseman in their system that are ready to elevate their game enough where they warrant consideration at the major league level. So I think he stays at first base. I wouldn't play Miguel Cabrera at first. Absolutely not. I would keep him as the designated hitter. That's just my opinion. I think Jamer Candelario, if given the opportunity, can play a better first base. No doubt about that. I like Isak Paredes. I like him a lot. I don't know if he's ready for an everyday third baseman gig. Then you would have to, you know, rotate in a guy like Nico Goodrum or somebody of that ilk to play a little third base for you. But I would feel comfortable. He's going to get better defensively, I think, and I think he's going to get better offensively. I think he looks like she's shown that he's not overwhelmed at the major league level, that he belongs. And look, this is going to be some growing pains, man. I mean, when you've got a 21-year-old at third base and you got a young first baseman who's making the transition and you got a young shortstop, and who knows what you're going to do at second base, You and I are going to be talking about, oh my God, I can't believe that poor defensive play. Oh my gosh, I can't believe how long he's gone through a slump. This is what happens with young guys. I mean, unless you're Francisco Lindor, right? This is what happens. I don't think Isak Paredes or Jaber Candelario are going to be the next Matt Chapman or Nolan Arenado, but I think they're a good enough player to warrant being in that starting lineup. And maybe keeping that spot warm until a guy like Spencer Torkelson comes up and starts to kill it at the major league level, hopefully.
Yeah, we're going to jump all around. There's so many guys I want to ask you about, but let's get to starting pitching, which we thought was the strength of the team. Unfortunately, their combined ERA was like the second worst in all of Major League Baseball. Positives and negatives from the starting staff this year. I'm going to leave it that wide open for you, Matt.
Yeah, I think the positives were Spencer Turnbull leading the team in quality starts. You're looking for more consistency from him. Will you ever get it? I don't know that. I don't know the answer to that. We all know that he has the ability. The question is, can he do it mentally as much as physically? Too many walks, right? But I think overall he was a positive. I think Tarek Skubal was a positive. I really do. I think Jose Cisnero and Gregory Soto and Buck Farmer were positives. I really like the way Joe Jimenez ended the season. You know, he had 3 earned runs in his last 10 outings. That's not bad, right? And remember, he went through a tough spot. I have a warm spot in my heart for guys who are getting beaten up and punched out by fans and local media and then respond. Because I think it's really hard to do, especially in baseball, because the game is built on failure. I do believe Casey Mize, he'll be the first to admit, he did not perform the way he expected. Same with Matthew Boyd. So I think, and likewise for Michael Fulmer, although I look at Michael Fulmer's season more as a situation where he was rehabbing. It would be like he was rehabbing in Toledo. I think they found a spot for Daniel Norris. I think him coming out of the bullpen, I know he wants to start, but him and Tyler Alexander coming out as long relief guys are a perfect spot for them. I would like a right-hander to be able to do that as well. But overall, I think that they've got spots on where they can fit, you know? And then, you know, you're looking at a situation, Ivan Nova's an incomplete. Al Avila's probably going to have to sign a free agent pitcher. Who that is, I'm not sure, but you're probably going to need somebody to finish up your staff. I mean, next year you're going to have Matthew Boyd, Spencer Turnbull, Tarek Skubal, question mark for your starting rotation as it looks right now.
Right. I'm going to give Casey Arthur Mize the benefit of the doubt. I think that he'll work it out. I thought that he was amazing in his post-game press conferences where,
Oh,
I mean, you could
yeah.
tell he was a little, he was disappointed, but he certainly wasn't defeated. And I think that's really a
Sure.
key, especially when you're looking at young players. I know we're running out of time, and I said we're going to jump around. Ron Gardenhire, obviously, maybe the biggest move Al Avila is going to have to make this year is who's
Yeah.
going to manage this club. What do you think the ingredients will be for the next Tiger manager? What must they have with this rebuilding team?
Yeah, it's a really good question. I think any good coach are, and you and I have been in plenty of locker rooms and clubhouses, the best coaches are great communicators. So this guy better be able to communicate well to players. That's a given, right? Analytics is so big in baseball, and the Tigers have spent an enormous amount of resources in building up their analytics department. So you better embrace that as well. Personally, I would like to see somebody be at least a bench coach. If I'm the Tigers, I wouldn't mind a young guy with some inexperience, but you got to have some bench coaching experience, something to plan ahead, something where your next move is. And obviously, the last thing is they've got to understand where the organization is, and they will. This organization may not be able to contend for a division title next year, but they're getting closer. So working with young guys, working on the fundamentals, and understanding from the top to the bottom, like Ron Gardenhire had helped build, top to the bottom, that method, that belief, that philosophy has to exude throughout each level of the organization.
Well, Matt, I have a warm spot in my heart for you, as you very well know. Thanks for joining us throughout this season. The word on Woodward isn't going away, nor is the Tiger Talk. So I know you're going to be joining us a lot during the off season as well. But I really do appreciate your time. That'll do it for this edition of The Headliner presented by Miller Lite. It is the original light beer. It's only 96 calories. It is delicious and it's available for delivery. Daniela, Matt Shepard, simply the best.